بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And جزاكم الله خير for joining us for day 13 of Little Ramadan Reminders. Today's topic, we will be talking about differences of opinion within Islam or اختلاف, and how it works, and the boundaries and the limits and the regulations that Islam lays down for where we're allowed to have differences and where we are not allowed to have differences. And when we look throughout all of history, we find that human beings have always had differences. You ask a question on any topic whatsoever and you'll get 20, 50, maybe 100 different answers. And so within Islam, this has to be regulated. You can't just have anybody say anything, because we're talking about the wisdom and the rulings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there has to be a relative amount of restriction. So the first question that we have to ask is, does Allah azza wa jalla allow any difference of opinion? And if He does, where exactly do those opinions exist? Where does this difference exist, and what does Islam allow? When we look at the history of Islam, we see that differences have existed since the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself amongst the Sahaba. We find that there were madahib, we find that there were different viewpoints on how to interpret, we find that there was difference of opinion on strength and weakness of ahadith, we find that there were schools of aqa'id. So within all of these, we find the Shafi'i, Hanafi, Hanbali, Maliki views within the schools of fiqh, and then we have the Athari and the Ash'ari, Maturidi, and so on within the different schools of aqidah, and then you had different schools of hadith, and so on and so forth. And so what we find is, historically, within Islam, all these differences existed and they coexisted, and the majority of them were very tolerant towards each other. But then sometimes we see some intolerance, where you see some accusations of this group is a deviant, or that view is outside the fold, or this is bid'ah, and so on. So how do we regulate all these things? This matter is simplified through something a little bit complicated. So today, I'm going to explain something that is a little bit complex, but If we understand it clearly, it simplifies this entire topic very, very clearly. And this matter revolves around the topic of qat'i and dhanni. Qat'i, it means absolute. It means there's no question about it. It means there's no two opinions are allowed about it. And then there's dhanni. Dhanni, it means that there's room for disagreement. It means that the conclusion that you reach is most likely. It's not 100%. There's a bit of doubt in it. You're not, you know, you can be even 95%. That 5% still exists. 99%, that 1% still exists. And therefore, the topic of dhanni and qat'i is what this whole topic of ikhtilaf revolves around, and this is where we identify what Islam allows and what Islam does not allow. And qat'i and dhanni can then be further subcategorized into dalala and thubut. And I'll explain them first, and then I'll show you how they are subcategorized. First of all, thubut. Thubut is referring to the chain of narration, back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if you have a hadith that says something, for example, صَلُّ كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي, pray as you see me pray. For example, when you find this hadith, you look at the chain of narration. So who transmitted this hadith to us today, or to the muhaddithin, like Imam Bukhari or Imam Muslim, and so on. So when we take this chain, we assess that this particular chain is reliable, because everyone in it has exceptional memory and they all meet the conditions of Imam Bukhari for a reliable narrator and a very strong hadith, and therefore we take this as being a narration that's acceptable and trustworthy. And it can be raised to the level of what is called mutawatir. It means that it's been narrated by so many people that it's impossible for there to have been a mistake in the narration itself. And this is thubut. So thubut is the chain of narration. As for al-dalala, once you've established that a narration is accurate or mutawatir, meaning absolutely 100%, then you talk about the dalala. Dalala, when you talk about dalla, for example, dalla tariqa and so on, when you're talking about somebody showing you the way or the indication, left and right and so on. So therefore, when we're talking about, in this particular context, we're talking about that the hadith, the words, and the ayat, the words that they contain, have more than one meaning. So when you, in English, we call it a homonym. So when you talk about, for example, a block, you say that there's a block, like you can say like a wooden block, like a toy block. You can say that there's a mental block, there's a street block, and so on. You can say a bat, there's a baseball bat, there's a flying bat, and so on. So all these different words have multiple meanings, multiple realities. So whenever you have an ayah or a hadith that has multiple meanings in it, that it could mean more than one thing, then in that particular case, we find that this is called dhanni al-dalala. So the dalala, it's not very clear. A qat'i al-dalala, so qat'i is absolute, it means there's only one meaning for the ayah or one meaning for the hadith. There's no question about what it means. There's only one thing. Whereas you have other ayat that have multiple meanings. For example, وَالْمُطَلَّقَاتُ يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ ثَلَاثَةَ قُرُوءٍ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the divorcees, the women who have been divorced, need to wait three quru'. So before they're allowed to marry again, so they have to wait three. And what does qurū mean? Some said that it means three menstruation periods. Some said that it's 3 months. There's difference of opinion on the meaning of the word qurū. So things like this, this is where we have dhanni al-dalala. So the meaning is dhanni, it's unclear. But the ayah itself is qat'i al-thubut. In terms of thubut, in terms of the chain, back to that knowing that this is exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, this is 100% qat'i, there's no question about it. So to review, we have dhanni and qat'i. And each one is subcategorized into thubut and dalala. So we have dhanni al-thubut, and dhanni al-thubut means that the chain of narration, there could be a possibility of error in it. And so that's why we have a dha'if hadith, and hasan hadith, and sahih hadith, and so on. But all of these are in the end dhanni, because there's a possibility of error in the narrators. They could have, even themselves, even the hadith, you'll hear them, you'll read them say that I'm not sure if he said this or that. And so you'll find even they themselves will narrate and they'll say they don't remember exactly what was said. So there's a bit of dhanni, uncertainty in the chain of narration. And then you have dhanni al-dalala, which is that the words of the final words, like the words have more than one meaning. We're not sure exactly what is meant by the words. So the first one is the chain of people. The second one is the narration itself has more than one meaning. As for qat'i al-thubut, it means that the chain is absolutely 100%, such as the mutawatir hadith and all of the Quran. Absolutely 100% of it is from Allah Azza wa Jalla, and there's no question about it. And then you have qat'i al-dalala, which is that the meaning of the words in it only have one meaning. So those evidences that only have one, for example, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ, say Allah is one. This is قَطْعِ الْدَلَالَةِ. There's only one single meaning for it. And anybody who disagrees on this, and this is the next point, people, any disagreement, anyone that has disagreement on something that is قَطْعِ, this is something Islam forbids. There's no disagreement on قَطْعِ. So anything, so questioning an ayah, saying this ayah is not accurate, somebody changed it, this is kufr. Saying that salah is four times a day. There's no such thing as salat al-fajr. There's no such thing as salat al-asr. This is, again, something Islam forbids. We're not allowed to disagree because this is قَطْعِ. It's five prayers a day. There's no question about it. It's all قَطْعِ الْدَلَالَةِ and قَطْعِ الْثُبُوتِ. These are قَطْعِ in both. So what is anything that's قَطْعِ, you're not allowed to disagree. But something could be قَطْعِ in terms of ثُبُوت, such as the Quran, it's 100% from Allah Azza wa Jal, but it's ظَنِّ الدَّلَالَةِ. So the words have more than one meaning. And other hadith could be قَطْعِ الدَّلَالَةِ. So the words, the hadith itself only has one meaning, but it's ظَنِّ الثُبُوت, meaning we're not 100% sure if the narration is accurate in the first place, as in it was, if it was transmitted, if it was narrated correctly by all the people in the chain of narration. And this is how Islam functions. The conclusion from all of this that we take is that what Islam allows us is to differ on anything dhanni. And it forbids us from differing on anything that is qat'i. And this is the very first general guideline for us. Now there's more to it, but I'm not going to go into too much detail. Just one more additional point, which is within the dhanni, not anything is open season. Essentially, with the dhanni, there are limitations. And it is guided and limited by the process of ijtihad. Islam has very specific and strict rules in the Arabic language, in using the Quran to interpret, using the hadith to interpret, using the rules and regulations of usul al-fiqh and usul al-tafsir, and so on and so forth. All these things have to come together with the people of knowledge, the qualified people who are able to identify what's strong and what's weak within the dhanni issues. Not anybody can just go say, well, this is dhanni and it could mean this. That's not how it works. Islam is a legislative system designed by Allah Azza wa Jal. And we find many examples among the Sahaba where we found that Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam allowed difference of opinion, and they lived that lifestyle of having ikhtilaf within the dhanni issues. One of the most beautiful examples is the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he told the Sahaba, لا يصلين أحدكم العصر إلا في بني قريظة. None of you are to pray Asr until you reach Bani قريظة. So they rushed towards Bani قريظة. But the problem was that Asr was passing as they were making their way to Bani قريظة. And they actually had not reached Bani قريظة, and Maghrib was about to begin. And so they stopped and said, we need to pray Asr. And they differed. They had ikhtilaf. They had difference of opinion. And so one group said that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant it literally. Don't pray until you reach Bani Qurayza. The other group said that no, he meant it figuratively, meaning get there as fast as you can. So those who held the opinion that it was figurative, they stopped and prayed. And what's really interesting, those who held the opinion that it was literal and that they had to rush, they still waited with their brothers as one ummah united, and they watched them pray, and they didn't pray. And then they continued to until they reached Bani Qurayza. Afterwards, they came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and told him about what happened. And what do you think he said? Do you think he said one was a deviant or did he reprimand somebody? No. He smiled and didn't correct them. He smiled and didn't tell them who was right. This is how Allah Azza wa Jal has taught us to organize our matters of ikhtilaf. When it comes to dhanni issues within the text of Islam, within the realm of what is allowed within ijtihad, within the what Islam allows for the linguistic meanings and so on, we are permitted to have disagreement. And within the qat'i issues, we're not okay with people having differences in qat'i issues. And this is where you have the deviant sects that have left Islam, such as the Ahmadis, and you have the Baha'is and so on. These are people who believe either in a new prophet or some weird form of reincarnation and so on and so forth. And these are things that are qat'i issues, they contradict qat'i issues within the text of the Quran and Sunnah. And therefore, I hope this clarifies the point of when we approach difference of opinion amongst each other within matters of aqidah, such as the different schools of aqaid, especially issues of fiqh, where you say that this opinion is wrong or this opinion is right. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا حَكَمَ الْحَاكِمْ ثُمَّ اجْتَهَدْ فَأَصَاب فَلَهُ أَجْرًا وَإِذَا حَكَمَ فَاجْتَهَدْ فَأَخْطَأ فَلَهُ أَجْرًا. If the mujtahid, if the judge performs ijtihad and comes to the correct opinion, he receives two rewards or double the reward. And if he comes to an incorrect understanding, the incorrect conclusion, he gets one reward. And therefore, inshallah, we're all earning reward by remaining within the boundaries of Islam and performing ijtihad or following valid ijtihadat and doing our very best to understand them. Jazakumullah khair, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase our understanding and our tolerance for each other within what Islam has obligated upon us to be tolerant, to be patient in, and to allow us to stand firm on the qat'i issues where we're not allowed to have any difference of opinion on. And inshallah, we'll see you tomorrow. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.